Good afternoon, everyone. It's now 4 o'clock. It is time for the Salinas City Council meeting of July the 23rd. Would everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the city clerk please call roll?
Councilmember Barrera.
Here.
Councilmember Castañeda.
Present.
Councilmember Craig.
Here.
Councilmember De La Rosa.
Here.
Councilmember Lutz.
Here.
Councilmember McShane. Mayor Gunter.
Here. I want to thank everyone for being here today. We're going to start off. We have a proclamation for the Muscular Dystrophy Association. Do I have a representative from the, probably from the fire department, that would like to come forward?
Oh my God, I want to see Brian.
If you'll walk on up here to the center podium, please. Thank you. I'm just going to read a portion of it because I know that you've probably all read this and heard all of it. The Muscular Dystrophy Association days are July the 26th through the 28th, 2013. Whereas muscular dystrophy refers to groups of more than 43 neuromuscular diseases that caused generalized weakness and muscle wasting. Two of the most common neuromuscular diseases include, and don't ask me, I'm going to mess this up, I know. Duchenne muscular dystrophy, a disease found in children that progresses slowly with a survival rare beyond their late 20s. And amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, Lou Gehrig's disease, a disorder that progresses rapidly in adults. Whereas members of the Salinas Firefighters Association serve and protect communities throughout Salinas every day, and have become a symbol of pride and honor and strength. And whereas members of the Salinas firefighters selflessly donate their time and energy to supporting and battling against muscular dystrophy. Whereas in 2012, the Salinas firefighters local association members hit the streets for MDA, Fill the Boot campaign, raising more than $28,000. Now, therefore, I, Joe Gunter, Mayor, hereby proclaim that July 26th, 27th, and 28th is MDA days in Salinas, California, and urge everyone to fill the boot. If you'd like to say a few words and then come up and I'll give you your plaque. Who's going to talk?
We'd just like to say thank you from our association, Local 1270, the Salinas Fire Department, and the Muscular Dystrophy Association. This is something that we've been doing for many years now, and it's definitely a worthwhile thing, and it's something that the community and the council and the entire city has really come to help support us, and we just want to say thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. If any of you are driving around on those days and you see them, they'll be standing out there with a boot and they just need a few of your dollars. So if everybody threw a few in, they can probably top next year. Okay, we have a couple of presentations tonight. The first one will be Monterey County Commission on Disabilities, and we're going to receive a presentation from Stella Larman.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and council members. I'm here to give a brief presentation on the on the Monterey County Commission on Disabilities. I'm Stella Lauerman. I'm the Director of Program Services for Easter Seals Central California, and I'm also the Outreach Chair for the Monterey County Commission on Disabilities. The Commission is an advisory board to the Board of Supervisors, and advises the board on matters relating to equal access for employment, public services, communications, and public accommodations for people with disabilities. So the commission exists to serve people in Monterey County with sight, hearing, mobility, cognitive, and other impairments and other disabilities. So the commission is comprised of representatives of appointed by each of the five supervisors, and those people serve, their term is determined by the supervisor who appoints them. We also have representatives from the cities within Monterey County and from various community-based organizations such as Easter Seals, Hope Services, Central Coast Center for Independent Living, and rather various other nonprofit organizations that serve people with disabilities as well. Also, we have a representative from the Monterey County Department Heads Council and the director of the County Resource Management Agency. So our terms are for 3 years and with a maximum of 6 consecutive years. And we have staff from the Equal Opportunities Office. The commissioners are volunteers, but the staff is our county employees from the Equal Opportunities Office. And basically, I'm here just to let you know about the commission and to make the information available both as information for the council members and the mayor, but also for the public. Anyone who has a concern regarding disability issues, access issues. I have a 23-year-old son with high-functioning autism. I'm very well connected in the disability community, and I didn't know that this commission existed until someone told me. So as part of our outreach efforts, we are speaking to all the city councils. We've made several presentations already and have several more to do throughout the county just to let people know that the commission is available as a public forum. It's a Brown Act meeting. It's open to the public. And there is a time for public comment during during each of the meetings. So they meet over here at the county building, 168 West LaSalle on the second floor. Typically, the meetings are the fourth Monday of every other month. So the next meeting is actually next week on the 29th. And typically, it's on the odd-numbered months, the fourth Monday of the month. So the contact information is there, on, and you have a copy of this handout, which I left with the clerk. And also the contact information for the Equal Opportunity Office websites, phones, and all, just in case you need any information. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present. Mr. Mayor?
Thank you. What we'll do now is we will go to the council members to see if any of them have questions for you. Mm-hmm. And do I have any questions to my right? Councilmember Barrera, Councilmember to my left?
Hi, Stella.
Hello, Jose.
Does this commission advise not only the counties, but the cities within the county for policies?
No, it like I said, it's a county commission. So members, the cities are invited to send a representative for their respective cities as a sitting member or to come to the meetings, but it's strictly an advisory committee to the Board of Supervisors.
What their main objective is not policy related, or is it more on getting services out to?
It's more kind of like advocacy information, okay. Being a forum for people, anyone, whether it's someone in the public sector or a private citizen, whomever has a concern regarding any kind of accessibility or disability related issues, to make sure that the people in Monterey County who have disabilities are appropriately served.
Where as a city, can we obtain more information such as demographic breakdowns or percentages?
From the Equal Opportunity Officer, Ms. Irma Ramirez-Bau. She is the person who handles all those matters for the county. And her information is on the flyer there.
Great. Is there any funding opportunities as well for cities that go over and beyond providing services to members of the community that have disabilities?
That I really don't know. You would have to ask Ms. Ramirez-Bau. The commission does recognize businesses and municipalities who have done an exceptional service or have gone out of their way. We do an annual awards to recognize those businesses and municipalities who have been particularly helpful to people with disabilities.
Aside from this, Stella, because I know you're very familiar with many resources out there in the community and county, is there any other agencies, organizations, or public entities that team up with this commission with disabilities to provide more services?
Many. We have a member from MST, from the transportation. We have a member from the Deaf and Hard of Hearing group. As I mentioned, various nonprofit agencies like Easter Seals, Hope Services, Cecil, that serve people with disabilities. So it's people who are representatives of the various municipalities plus nonprofit organizations.
Great. Thank you, Stella. Mayor, was this the commission you were referring to last time when we met as a council and we wanted to appoint someone from?
That is correct. Okay. I was looking for someone to provide me with some names. I've had a couple presented so far, and we are still working on that.
Okay, great. So that's still...
What will happen is we give them an application to fill out. They have to turn into Patty Barajas, the city clerk, and then we will review them and pick someone to represent the city of Salinas.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilmember McShane? Is there anyone in the audience that would like to ask a comment? Seeing none, we will now go back to council members for comments. Councilmember Barrera.
Well, I just want to thank you for the good work that you're doing. You know, a lot of times we don't concern ourselves for certain disabilities that other people suffer from, but it's good to have it in front of us. That way we can hear it and be able to be proactive and...
Right. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
On behalf of all the commissioners as well, thank you very much. So, thank you all for your time.
One moment. You don't get away that easily.
Sorry.
Councilwoman Lutz.
First of all, Stella, again, thank you for your presentation. I hadn't realized that the umbrella of disabilities would also include especially autistic children. And so are you, I'm assuming that you're pretty involved with the schools and trying to identify families. Mm-hmm. And
absolutely.
Good. Okay. Do you have brochures that can be displayed at schools?
About the commission, you mean?
Yes.
Yes. Great. The Office of Equal Opportunity can provide those brochures for you.
Thank you. Great presentation.
Thank you very much.
Anyone else on my left?
Yes. Stella, if we can, we're looking at future upcoming study sessions for the council. Mm-hmm. And I just want to go ahead and put this out there on the floor for the council. Disabilities have many different components to it. Mentally, physically, and then my council member colleague to my right mentioned about the autistic.
Yes.
So it goes a wide variety of ranges. To do a couple of minutes or so of a presentation, I think, doesn't really suffice for us to address many of the different mm-hmm. needs in our communities. But if we look in the future to see how we can have more of a presentation or even participate mm-hmm. with you if we have to on a one-on-one basis or so, just so we can go ahead and get more familiar with what else we can
absolutely.
Participate and engage
as policymakers.
I'd be more
than happy to do that. Like I said, my particular area of personal expertise is autism, but as I said, we have commissioners who are the chair of our commission is deaf and hard of hearing himself, and we have people from across various who are very familiar with various disabilities, so we'd be more than happy to do that.
Right, but nevertheless, thank you for being here, Stella. We appreciate that, and it's something very important that does merit to be on the agenda so we can continue with more services.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Thank you for coming. We certainly appreciate all the hard work you're doing.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and council members. I very much appreciate your time.
Thank you. Now we have another bind administrative report coming up from the Joint Community Safety Division Recreation Services Update. We're going to receive a report from Director Georgina Mendoza McDowell and Community Service Manager Kristen Lundquist.
That's right. Good afternoon, Mayor and members of the City Council. I'll be here with my colleague, Kristen Lundquist.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the Council. My name is Kristen Lundquist, and I oversee the Recreation Division of the Library and Community Services Department, and I'm really excited to be here and present with Georgina on the critical work that we're doing in the community.
So yes, Mayor, I know we have a limited time, and we will be respectful of that. However, there's so many good things to talk about, so that's why we needed two of us to be here. First thing is, we're going to talk about what it takes to create a community. It takes a lot. It takes a comprehensive approach, looking at it, PIER, which is prevention, intervention, enforcement, and reentry. Today, we're only going to touch a little bit on some of the preventative work that we're doing here in the city of Salinas. And that doesn't include all the wonderful work that our partners are doing in prevention. We're simply going to focus on the city efforts for prevention. We talk about the need and the absolute necessity to have community engagement, real, deep, meaningful engagement in every part of our community. For violence is something that affects 100% of our community, not just certain areas, but directly and indirectly, it affects all of us. We talk about having meaningful opportunities for youth and families. So it isn't sufficient to say, hey, you should no longer be in the violent lifestyle. They need to have viable alternatives, and we see it as our responsibility to really help with those opportunities, and more importantly, engage in prevention so that they don't even have to get to that level. One of the most important things that we do also, and I'll talk a little bit more about it, is the Leadership Academies. In fact, we have some graduates here from the Líderes Academy. Can you raise your hand? Levante la mano. There's some. There's actually a lot of them, but they said they actually got out of work and are here. They're superstars. And so again, because we have the vision of having a city at peace, can't have peace if there is a lack of opportunities and lack of alternatives for our families and our youth. Whoops. One of the first things I wanted to talk about were the night walks. We've been doing this for approximately 1 year. We started in May of 2012, and it's really a proven successful prevention strategy. This is something that's been going on in the city of Boston for over 20 years, with success rates of up to 70% less in crimes where these night walks take place. This is actually part of what is known as the Boston Miracle 10-point coalition. In fact, its director who started this, Reverend Jeff Brown, came to Salinas twice, once to start it and again in the one-year anniversary to come and do further training, along with Pastor Eddie Caraveo from Sacramento and Victory Outreach, who has also been implementing this very successful strategy for about 4 years, also seeing similar reductions in crime. In the city of Salinas, we are currently doing these walks in three different areas, all of them data-driven. What does that mean? It means that we work with our police officer colleagues to determine what are those areas, those hotspots in the city. So statistically, we look at where most of the crimes are. We look at what day, what time, so that we can be most efficient and really be preventative in nature when we do these night walks. We're at the Hebron area, Closter Park, and Acosta Plaza. This is really an great volunteer opportunity. We have members from different parts of the community walking in these areas. We have people that aren't even from Salinas that want to help and that engage in these night walks. So they say, one, it's a proven strategy. It's something we can do. It doesn't cost money. And some of them say, I even get to do some cardio exercise when I do this and really get to meet some great people. In fact, this has become a successful program here as well, and it is clergy and faith-led, as well as any community member that wants to be a leader of it. When we recently had our one-year training and retraining of this, we had members from the cities of San Jose, Sacramento, Long Beach, and Santa Rosa, who also now want to implement this strategy. So it's very exciting for us. The Leadership Academy, so far, we just started in the fall of 2012. We have 34 leaders. And again, this is in less than a year. These are individuals who take time out of their very busy schedule, working full-time, have kids, and understand that if there is going to be a sustained, significant impact in our community, it needs to start in the home. It needs to start with the actual community members. And that is, in fact, what you see there. You see individuals who take matters into their own hands and who learn skills such as advocacy, public speaking, goal development, organizing, how to run a meeting, why do we need an agenda, things of that nature, and now are off and running, really doing their own projects. They're nodding their heads because they've been busy and continue to meet even after their recent graduation of June 8th. We actually have a current Leadership Academy that is focused for young people, and they are receiving information on life skills, things like How do I complete a resume, a cover letter? How do I dress for an interview? How do I shake hands? How do I make eye contact? As well as learning about leadership skill development. So again, we know that that is a wise investment in our future. We have a third Leadership Academy coming up in the fall. Again, we'll be completely free, open for 25 members of the community from any part of the community that wishes to receive these kinds of skills. This is all really with the help of the PSN, which is the Project Safe Neighborhoods grant that I believe is actually in the consent agenda, that is helping pay for these three leadership academies, as well as receiving amazing help from our CAS partners that are providing services in kind. They're the facilitators. They provide trainings. We work with CAS. We work with people like Second Chance, like Partners for Peace, Harmony at Home, just really the people that are in the trenches and like to help completely volunteer their time. And at this point, I will pass it on to Kristen so that she can talk about the amazing things that she's doing with CalGrip 6.
Thank you, Georgina. Recreation has been involved with CASP and provided support to community safety for some time now. And because of those relationships, we were asked to participate in the CalGrip 6 grant. CalGrip, for those of you, it stands for California Gang Reduction Intervention and Prevention Program. And over the course of 2 years, the Recreation Division will be receiving a little over $100,000 in order to implement a Saturday evening teen program at the Breadbox Recreation Center and also enhance the existing program at the Hebron Family Center. Providing meaningful opportunities for youth during critical after-school hours is proven to prevent violence and other risky behaviors. The same can be said for weekends, and that's why we're focusing on Saturday evenings. The centers are open from 6 to 10 p.m., and we're focusing on youth ages 12 to 18. And I do have several members from the Breadbox, our youth that are here and to support, and also you may hear from a few of them as well. We're offering a variety of recreational and enrichment opportunities each Saturday evening that build confidence, resiliency, and conflict resolution skills. We began implementing this program in March, and since that time, Since that time, we've served 110 individual teens and also had over 750 program visits. And when I talk about program visits, I'm talking about the attendance that we see every Saturday and then compounded from March until now. We work with different agencies. Second Chance has been a great partner. Some of their street outreach workers are here, and they're with us on Saturday evenings. They're providing additional supervision, and they're also engaging with the youth. We also are working with the CAS police team. Officers Lopez and Rosales have been out to engage with the youth and are really helping to build relationships with the teens and also the community as a whole. Why is it a success? There's a couple of reasons I'd like to point out. First, how many times have we heard from kids, especially teens, there's nothing to do in Salinas, especially on a weekend, right? Well, this is what we're doing. We're giving them a safe place to come. We have positive adult mentors that are building relationships with them. And I'd just like to say one of the first Saturdays in March when I was out at the Breadbox, we had a room full of kids, the radio was blaring, and one of the teens came up to get his nachos. We also serve them dinner each Saturday night. And as he comes up, he has a big smile on his face and he's bopping to the music and he says, "This is so cool." And that just reinforced why we do what we do and why it's so critical. Another reason it's a success is because of our staff. We have dedicated recreation staff who are in the centers day in and day out and really working to build relationships. They're creating a family environment. They're being that positive role model and caring adult, asking these youth, how was your day? How was your family? How was school? Helping them through some challenging situations that they may find themselves in. And as we all know, among many reasons, one of the reasons youth turn to gangs is because they're looking for a sense of belonging, want to be part of something. Well, these programs at the Breadbox in Hebron, and quite frankly, all of our recreation centers, really provide a positive opportunity and a positive place for them to belong and be part of. The Hebron Family Center is one of our neighborhood recreation centers, and it truly is a community resource center. The facility is used 7 days a week, and we have over 150 monthly activities and programs that take place there. If you've ever been out there, every nook and cranny is used, and we try to make the most of the space. We have about 75,000 annual visits to the center and programs. We offer a variety of recreational opportunities there. We have a Tiny Top program, which is a recreation play school for ages 3 to 5, and they're focusing on kindergarten readiness. We have an after-school program for elementary through high school youth. We have a karate program, and we also have a Girl Scout troop, which I'm pleased to announce we have about 25 girls involved in the troop now, which is really good. We also have a strong teen volunteer program. Some of you may recall about a year ago, we brought 7 or 8 of our teens to be recognized before the council because of the great work that they do. Last fiscal year alone, our teens performed over 370 hours of community service for the neighborhood. They're learning to give back and the importance of community. The facility is also used by many agencies. Georgina's mentioned some and, earlier, but Harmony at Home is there, the Citizenship Project, CASP, A Time for Grieving, and the Monterey County Health Department are all among the 19 agencies that utilize the facility. Now I'll turn it back to Georgina, and she's going to give you an update on what the CASP efforts that are going on in the Hebron area.
Thank you, Kristen, and I know I have about 30 seconds to tell you about everything that CASP is doing, but I won't. I'll narrow it down, and I'll let you know that we're very proud of our community-wide violence reduction plan. We recently underwent some efforts to completely update this plan that was originally for 2010 to 2012 to now cover 2013 and 2018. As we did in 2010, we worked directly with community members as well as researchers and quantitative information. But most importantly, we worked with the community. We held listening sessions. We had a number of community dialogue meetings. We went to the centers. We went wherever people wanted us to go so that they can provide feedback. I'm going to kind of spoil this a little bit. But at the end, we have a collage for you. That's the last slide. One of them that you'll see are some of our young folks over at the Hebron Family Center at a Saturday night, okay, voluntarily helping me give a youth voice so that they can represent the voice as to what they wanted in their strategic work plan. And so you'll see them. There were actually 6 posters with 6 of the focus areas, and they talked about what they felt was the most important strategies, what their recommended solutions were, et cetera. Keep in mind, young people, there were nachos, there was pizza, there was candy bars. Saturday night, there was basketball. They were hanging out with me in my little research plan for about an hour, a little over an hour. They were engaged. So it's an amazing group. So again, we're very proud that we worked on that. We have submitted a rough, finalized, closely draft of this plan. We're waiting to get some suggestions and recommendations so we can fully implement it and get it going again. Because really, this is a guideline that we all use so that we can be strategic and coordinated in the very limited resources that we all have. We make sure that we're not duplicating anything. We want to make sure that we're helping bolster one another as much as we can and that we're being responsive to the community needs. Because of this plan and our participation in the National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention, along with now 9 other cities, Salinas still a very small city in that, along with Boston, Detroit, Chicago, Memphis, we have Minneapolis, New Orleans, Philadelphia, just a number of cities. We have Salinas still there. Why? Because we're a national leader. We don't have all the answers yet, but we know which way we're going, and we've been moving there forward for the last at least 3-4 years. We have a plan, we know what we need to do, and we're moving forward with that. So we're very proud of that. We've been able to be extremely competitive in grant applications. You've all received a presentation from me actually talking about all the different grants and the millions that we've been able to bring in to our community. So again, it makes us competitive because we have a great community, we have a comprehensive approach, and we work in a coordinated fashion. The pilot side of the implementation of this plan is the Hebron area. Now, the reason for it is, yes, there is a lot of crime that occurs there. Yes, we have 2 active gangs that are there, but we also have a lot of wonderful resources, not to mention, of course, the wonderful Hebron Family Center. Kristen's not kidding when she says that every square inch of that center is used 7 days a week, because the people really see it as their center. And so it's a wonderful meeting place and an opportunity for people just to go and enjoy that. So that's where we have it. We've been there for about a year now. This is where the CASP cross-functional team meets. And again, the wonderful folks that I mentioned, our CASP partner agencies, are there working specifically right now to address the issues and concerns that our young people have in the Hebron area. We center and we focus ourselves on the young person. From there, we look at his or her family, their household, what's going on in their streets, neighborhood, and schools. And so we all work together. Just in the last year alone, we've seen 11% reduction in violent crimes, 28% reduction in property crimes, and an amazing work of prevention that police is doing, which is also traditionally just seen as suppression, the wonderful prevention work that is being done by the CASP officers there, Rich Lopez and Raul Rosales, who you actually see in the picture. He's wearing the white polo, hanging out with a little boy, and they were racing. It has really helped, so I really want to thank the police for that. And I know Kristen has more to say about prevention.
So prevention programs like the ones offered by recreation are essential to solving our youth and gang violence problems that we have in this community. In reality, recreation and prevention programs really are that third leg to the public safety stool. As Georgina mentioned earlier, it takes a comprehensive approach, and prevention is just as critical as enforcement efforts. Recreation is serving youth ages 3 to 18 and our seniors as well. We have 6 recreation centers, including the Bread Box, Hebron Family Center, Central Park, El Dorado Park, the Firehouse, and the Recreation Center on Lincoln Avenue. And we issue permits for 10 different sports facilities. We offer a variety of programs. I've mentioned some of the ones from Hebron and the Bread Box. But like all of our recreation centers, Central Park has an after-school program for youth. El Dorado has Tiny Tots, karate, and a variety of cultural programs. And our seniors are housed at the Firehouse Recreation Center. We also have 15 youth sports programs that are administered through the Recreation Center on Lincoln Avenue. Really, the benefits of recreation are endless, and all of these programs provide opportunities for socialization, early literacy, enrichment, skill building, teamwork, and conflict resolution skills, just to name a few. Recreation is all about youth and community engagement. Oh, thanks, Georgia. Again, we're all about youth and community engagement. I've mentioned a lot about the youth engagement, which, as in the plan Georgina mentioned, engaging youth is one of the critical focus points. There's 6 of them, and youth is certainly at the center, as she mentioned. We also do a lot within the community, whether it's a block party, our Hebron Fall Harvest, or our spring event and cleanup. We're out there building relationships with the community and helping to foster strong neighborhoods. We also do work with agencies in the community, such as Poder Popular. We've been involved with them for the last couple of years, and we've helped with their Dia del Niño event. And we've also, thanks to a partnership with Poder Popular, been able to bring skating opportunities to La Paz Park. Skate Days occurs between March and September, and we bring out our portable skate equipment to the park and give neighborhood youth from that area an opportunity to skate. Each year, we see over 290,000 annual visits to all of our recreation centers and programs. In conjunction with our summer recreation program, we also offer a free lunch program, and that's in collaboration with the LaSalle Union School District. Last summer alone, we served over 20,000 free lunches to 5 of our neighborhood recreation centers, as well as a satellite library site. This slide really kind of gives you a forecast or shows you where our budget has been over the last 5 years. As you can see, in fiscal year 9-10, we had just under $3.5 million in terms of budget resources and 22 full-time staff. In fiscal year 10-11, that was drastically reduced down to under $1.5 million and down to 6.5 staff. We currently have been holding pretty steady at a budget with of $1.4 million and 6 full-time equivalent staff. The next slide is a general fund and Measure V fiscal year 13-14 expenditures. And as you can see, again, recreation's budget is about $1.4 million, which is 2% of the city's overall budget. Did you want to say?
Mine's really quick, because mine is actually under administration, where you see 1.5. Mine is actually a relatively new division that was just created in fall of 2011. And my total budget for the year that comes from the general funds is $219,300. We have three full-time employees. We make ends meet by grants. However, we will take what we get, and if that's about $220,000, then we'll make it work. Can we do more with more? Absolutely. But yeah, you'll see that mine is a little sliver in the administration.
So as I mentioned in a couple slides back, we did have a significant reduction in fiscal year 10-11, and recreation services were reduced by 58%. This has created some challenges in terms of supervision and program development. Our centers currently are left alone without full-time supervision approximately 36% of the time. And although temporary employees are the backbone of recreation and are so important to what we do and allows us to, you know, provide so many resources, having adequate full-time staff really is necessary to ensure liability and safety issues are addressed, as well as to make sure that we don't have, you know, program quality diminish. We're also dealing with aging infrastructure, and Public Works Director Gary Peterson gave a great presentation at the last council meeting with regard to the overall infrastructure needs. If you just pull out the recreation center needs alone, you're looking at about $2.1 million in terms of aging infrastructure. Salinas is a relatively young community. According to the 2010 census, 35% of Salinas' population is under the age of 19. That's about 50,000 youth within our community. As many of us know, the average age for joining a gang is between 12 and 14. That means prevention has to start so much earlier. We really have to reach out to these youth when they're 5, 6, and 7 years old. If you look at the cost of providing these critical recreation services to the community, in terms of a per capita standpoint, it really costs less than $10 per resident to provide these services. And if you take it one step further and you compare that cost to the 50,000 youth, you're talking about $28 to provide these services to this community. Investing in youth is cost-effective and it makes sense. Prevention is cheaper than enforcement, and also it's cheaper than housing an incarcerated youth. When you compare all the critical services that recreation provides per the per capita cost, isn't it amazing to see what we've been able to accomplish with such a small fraction of the budget? And if you could just take a minute and think about what we could do and what we could achieve with just a little bit more. Also, I just want to point out, the recreation also supports your council goals of safe and livable communities, quality of life, and excellent infrastructure as well. And youth are our future, right? So we have to invest in them. Again, prevention is just as critical as enforcement, and recreation looks forward to be part, to be continuing to be part of a public safety team that really works to achieve a more peaceful community here in Salinas. And this is the collage that Georgina mentioned. I think it definitely tells a story of the important and the critical work that both community safety and recreation does within the community. This concludes our presentation, and Georgina and I are both available for any questions that you may have.
Thank you. We're going to go to the council for questions at this time. Do I have any questions on my right? To my left, do we have any questions?
Thank you for the presentation. Are you 100% funded only by grants? Or is there, if you would, either one, if whoever can answer regarding the budget, I'm catching on to the last comment at the end that imagine what we can do if we had a little more. So I'm trying to find out if, are you 100% funded by grants only? Or is there, if you were to break it down, just not looking for details, but if you were to break it down by percentages, how much is grants, private donations, and so forth, maybe some city funding, or I'm trying to get a breakdown, a visual breakdown.
Okay. I'll go first because mine's a little bit easier. The general fund money that we have is a little over $219,000, so that'll cover our staff. However, we also have to really rely on funds from grants so that we can get things like supplies and other necessities that come up with coordination of CASP, as well as programs that we run and coordination with leadership academies.
Great.
The Recreation Services budget really is supported pretty close 50-50 between General Fund and Measure V. We do have some grants. We receive some community development block grant funds for after-school programming at the Breadbox, Hebron Family Center, and the Firehouse Recreation Center as well. And then, as I mentioned, we also did, we are part of the CalGRIP 6 grant, so we did receive some money to expand our programming for Saturday evenings as well.
Great. So now to the following question. How much is a little? If we were to imagine to have a little, how much would that be to make a difference, aside from what you have presented already?
Well, as I mentioned, our current per capita costs are about $10 per resident. In all honesty, I don't think it would be unreasonable to spend $20 per resident. Obviously, that's dependent upon the city's resources as we move forward, but certainly, you know, I've been told that, you know, it costs about $300,000 to save or to incarcerate somebody? So,
exactly.
You know.
Used to be in the low hundred thousands.
Yeah. So, anyways, I think, you know, when you look at the cost of saving the youth, that's what's so important here as we move forward.
That's great. I think for the council to consider, and this is a perfect timing to be in front of the council and the public, you're right, now it has increased to the $300,000 or so. Public dollars for public education, it's about $7,500 to $7,800 per student to educate. When you look at the East Coast, New Jersey, New York, and so forth, those East Coast states, obviously their education is at a higher state. They're spending $15,000 to $17,000 per student. So you can see the difference between the disparity of California and the East Coast in education. After school spending right now, just to go with some numbers that I know myself, we're looking at roughly from about $1,200 to $1,400 in the low end to about $3,700 in the high end per student after school activities or before school activities. So to be asking for $28 is, I think, it's far, far too unreasonable to be asking for that. I think you should, this is a perfect time to ask for the moon, the stars, the sun. Pretend, no pun intended, but pretend you're the unions. Ask for more. You know, we're talking about children, we're talking about our youth, we're talking about our next generation. So I hope you can multiply that number 1,000 times fold if you can, because I think this council has seen far more enough evidence before our own eyes on what you guys are doing with very little. So thank you.
I really appreciate those comments. If we received more money, I can guarantee that we know what to do with it. So I will ask for the sun, moon, and stars, because I really think that that's what our community needs, and we can absolutely do that. This is our future, right? We are not going to have economic development without safety. We're not going to have people coming back from college if they don't feel like there's job developments and opportunities here. So absolutely, I think it's an investment worth making. Thank you.
Yeah, so if you can, maybe now, if you can reconsider what number you can provide to the council. But I think for us as council members, we need to look at even, I guess a good start would be doubling the budget for now. If not, let's think a bit bigger. But they provided a lot of documentation and evidence before us on what they're doing and how much they're reaching. It's no wonder why you're receiving the grants, because that requires documentation, the evidence of what you're doing already. So if we double, triple, quadruple your budget, obviously that will multiply your numbers in that fashion.
Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, very impressive, Georgina, Kristen. Your enthusiasm and passion for what you do is really good. You can teach anybody anything. You can't teach passion. I don't think the need's ever gone away. There's always been a need for recreation and for safety in the way that you facilitate it. So I guess two things I would focus on. It looks like the grants all but dried up based on this graph. So I guess there's some grants that aren't reflected
That's correct. There's some grants that are outstanding that we have, the Project Safe Neighborhoods. We have CalGRIP 5 and we have CalGRIP 6. CalGRIP 6 is the one that's actually paying for the summer youth programs, as well as the parenting projects of Partners for Peace and a lot of the work that we do out in the community.
But
it's not reflected.
2-3%, 5%, it's not more than 10%, right? Okay. So to that point, you know, as a city, we're a poor city, and we've had to sacrifice a lot of services that may have been around 20 years ago. You call the fire department 20, 30, 40 years ago, and they might help get the cat out of the tree. Today, that's not the case. And to that tune, where do you see the role of the nonprofit community? The folks that I know that are partners in the nonprofits that aid and help in keeping kids on the right path, business is booming. I can't say they're getting the grants or the funding that they like. You know, as you've seen the nature of the city change, services that we used to maintain and provide, say Sherwood Hall for now, or the pool, where has the nonprofit world come into play? And do you work with the nonprofit world, and is there the kind of alignment and teamwork that you'd want?
Absolutely. The nonprofit organizations, CBOs, are really some of our key partners in CASP. In fact, a lot of the ones that I mentioned here, Second Chance, Partners for Peace, and Harmony at Home, have really been stepping it up and working with the limited resources that they have. But again, we're doing so in a coordinated, strategic fashion. Now, everybody, every sector has to be part of this comprehensive approach. And that includes the private funders. That includes private sectors. So businesses, we do have resources here. And everybody has a role that they can play. We are currently working, one of our key members for the cross-functional team and in CASP is Margaret Dorigo from Taylor Farms. Sure. And she's been doing an amazing job in terms of trying to help us with that. So have the schools, including Hartnell, CSUMB, HEALD. So we're really trying to bring everybody to the table because everybody really has something wonderful to share.
What happens, and this may or may not be an appropriate question, what happens, as I think I've heard, you may be leaving the city. Is the cart going to topple? You know, what sort of plans, what sort of sustainability is built into what you're doing and you're working in concert with recreation?
That relationship will remain intact, whether I'm here or not. I mean, this is my city, so my heart's always here. But physically, I will be leaving. My last day is August 22nd, working as a City of Salinas employee after being here for about 7.5 years. So the work, though, that we have been doing for the past few years now has really been, again, strategic, coordinated. We have wonderful people like Jose Arriola, who, raise your hand, thank you, program manager, who's really been stepping up and doing amazing work. I have Julia Nix from my, who's my assistant. And then we have people like Kristen and her wonderful staff. We have the libraries. We have a lot of wonderful people that are still coordinated within the city, let alone all the agencies, 50 plus, maybe 60 plus in CAST, the Community Alliance for Safety and Peace. We got a plan, we have a vision, and so we are moving that way. I just sadly don't get to be part of it much longer.
Sure, sure. And maybe the last question, Mr. Mayor. You know, the neighborhood movement that you guys know I'm tied into in some ways. The first thing I would say is I need to get to the Hebron Family Center. I need to do my part to try to bridge what I think has been largely a South Side energized, you know, Lorna, Monterey Park Neighborhood Watch, but I do believe in other parts of the city, there's been more neighborhood watch, more neighborhood associations that have kind of grown over the last 5-6 years. A lot of them more tied to safety as opposed to, say, diversion or keeping kids off the street. How do you see that bridges could be built there? And because it's a safety part as well, it just seems like it's coming from different energy centers, whether it be, again, youth or whether it be adults that, you know, don't want to have their house broken in. Where and how are bridges being made with just, you know, folks across the city, particularly on the south side? I mean, to consider the district for just a second. It seems like so much of the energy that you're committed to is dedicated in another geographic portion of the city.
Right, and again, this is a citywide comprehensive plan. Just like I said in the beginning, you know, safety is something that affects 100% of us. There may be some that say, well, certain violence only occurs in certain sides. The fact is that it's occurring in every part of our city. There's different kinds of violence, there's different effects that people have. Again, there's direct and indirect exposure to violence. You know, there might be people from a side of Salinas or streets in Salinas that directly are impacted by violence. There are some that maybe are impacted by the fact that they have to pay for the hospital bills, prosecution, incarceration. That's all coming out of their pockets. The fact that their children are friends with a lot of the young kids that are being impacted directly. It's really all of our kids that are being impacted. And I think that's something that we're bringing here, is the fact that we're not just focusing on one particular area or not focusing on another one. This is a citywide comprehensive plan. We all have the responsibility to do something. Mm-hmm. And whoever wants to be part of it is absolutely welcome to it, because there's so much great energy. When we were doing the revision of the plan, we went to different parts of the city. We actually gave a presentation and worked with the neighborhood council. You were here.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and that was really good energy. So to be able to get feedback from different sectors of our community, I think is absolutely critical. Again, I think long gone are the days where people said, hey, only certain sides of Salinas or of the city are being impacted. That's no longer the truth. And I'm hopeful that we're going to be able to work even closer as a city, regardless of what district or neighborhood you come from.
The spirit. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're now going to go to the public for comment on this issue. Is there anyone in the public that would like to comment? Please walk up to the microphone and state your name, please.
Good afternoon. My name's Jasmine.
Good afternoon. My name is Moses.
The reason why I like to go to Bread Box is because there's lots of fun activities, like, for example, basketball, pool, ping pong, volleyball, and lots of other fun things to do. And the reason why I go there is because I feel safe. And the staff are very kind, polite, and they take their time to be with young people. Yes. Like us.
Basically the same thing as she said. There's nice staff. I thank Christy for providing everything for all these youth. And yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
My name's Richard, and I go to Bread Box because it's like fun. I hang around with my friends right there. It's a good place to train on basketball, trying to be on the, you know, hard-nosed basketball team. So it's a good place to train, and it's really safe for me.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is Fidel. I like to go to Bread Box because I think it's safe and fun for all ages.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I like to go to Bread Box because overall it's a safe environment, regardless whether the recent teen nights they're having and basically the regular hours Monday through Saturday. Like previously stated by Richard, it's a good place, sports, train basketball, working on your shooting, dribbling, or et cetera. Anything that would help you get better at the sport, pretty much.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Okay, my name is Kathy Bauer. I'm the director of Partners for Peace, and I wanted to say thank you for the opportunity to be here, and thanks to Kristen and Georgina. We're partially funded by CalGRIP 6 and CalGRIP 5, and let me just tell you a little bit about Partners for Peace as background, and I have a little cheat sheet that I'll give you at the end. So Partners for Peace has been around since 1995. Actually, Anna Cabrera, the former mayor, served as its first executive director. Our whole focus is to prevent violence. We build strong families for a more peaceful future, which is our motto. So I'd just like to explain three key programs that we offer toward that vision. We offer the Strengthening Families Program, which is evidence-based, a national program, and that we serve. It started in 2005 with Dan Villarreal, a probation officer, and to date, we've served more than 3,500 parents and youth in the greater Salinas area. And let me show you this is kind of fun. Do I have to use the microphone? I'm a teacher at heart, right?
Sure.
So, I just wanted to show you what it's about. This is 250 parents.
Isn't this the outcomes we want for families? Talking, consequences, limits. The bigger the word, the more frequent the response. So that's what that's all about.
We offer, CalGRIP pays for 10 classes a year, and we offer 30 from other funding sources. We also have a brand new program called Parent Project, which has been funded by CalGRIP 6 through the City of Salinas, and we're very excited. Now, that's a true example of a collaboration that Georgina was talking about. We had a 40-hour training that was attended by two of the police officers, again, Rosales and Lopez, who taught one of the first classes in LSL, and it was phenomenal. I wish you could have been there. Oh, is that my 2 minutes? Oh, God. Okay. Parent Project, Step Up Parent, Step Up Mentoring we also do. And I just want to thank Tony. He's on our board of directors. He understands what building strong families takes. And I'll close with a quote that I believe to the depths of my soul. There is no single effort more radical in its potential for saving the world than transformation of the way we raise our children. Mm. We have to be positive role models. And parents don't know how to raise kids these days, unfortunately. So thank you.
Any questions?